Monsters now. Over on the side, we have Draskal and Odie Pixel.
Thank you very much, Dakota. Indeed, here we are getting ready for the first game of day two of the main stage, eHome versus Alliance in a best of three. The draft is complete, and the Alliance going up against eHome. eHome seen as one of the stronger sides in this tournament. It's going to be quite a game.
I mean, I wish Alliance the best of luck. I do personally like their draft a little bit more, but eHome showed in the group stage they are insanely powerful, so I'm really looking forward to this match and seeing if Alliance can kind of stem the tide that is eHome.
Absolutely. As you said, with Alliance's draft, it's very Alliance-esque. It's similar to a lot of the stuff we saw them do in the group stages. I mean, just to go back, I believe it was the game against Na'Vi where we saw just how ridiculously powerful the Cold can be with the pushes. Just sitting outside the base, giving them an insane amount of sustain when they get the good timing on the Aghanims. And we can expect to see that happen for the side of Alliance.
It's not even just about the health sustain that you're going to get from the hero. It's also about enabling like Storm and the Bristleback to be able to spam spells and being able to get in and out of fights on Storm is what he's made for. And that's the whole reason eHome last pick is Sand King. They need something that's a reliable disable to ensure that they can actually kill him during some stage. But as the panel already mentioned, eHome pretty reliant on their lanes here. See what they're able to accomplish.
In terms of eHome's lineup as well, a lot of hero picks that they're very familiar with and still not kind of straying far from what we saw from them in terms of drafts during the group stage. What is the plan here for eHome? Are they looking to just contain Alliance in the early game, slow down the push, the aggression that they're going to look for with the Drow Ranger, and then come and hit back hard as the game goes on towards the mid and later stages?
They just want to pressure the lanes a lot. Like, you have an Undying, for example. This hero is... it's something that you pick when you want to make sure you're applying pressure somewhere. So if Lanham is able to do this dual offlane, get something done, maybe go for like the patented dive on the Drow or force maybe even the Coddle to change lanes. Because right now it seems like Alliance are doing the smart thing, just anticipating that there's going to be a dual aggressive lane from eHome. So they're just sending the Drow to the top lane to give him an easier matchup. And once eHome see this, they're going to have to, I think, at least send the Undying up there. Maybe they send both supports, we'll have to see.
So you say in terms of lane decision, this is Alliance reading eHome very
well. It's what they want to do, yeah. I mean, there's not anything stopping eHome from just teleporting the Undying to the top lane just to contest, but for now, it looks like they're just going to be sending Fenrir up instead.
Looks like there's as well, I mean, at the moment, Undying hanging around the mid lane, but we'll see if he does head up top to the join Forsters as well. There's Old Chicken already in the mid lane against S4. Doing okay. And I guess in this matchup as well, between the Moran and the Storm, unlikely that we're going to see any deaths here before rotation comes through, or is there a clear strength for one of the heroes?
Unless S4 eats an arrow, I kind of doubt that he's going to be dying in this matchup. And also consider the fact that he will have Precision Aura at some point. At level 1, Loda actually decided to skill the Frost Arrow just for harass, so he doesn't actually have it at level 1. I'm not sure if they're just feeling confident that, you know, Storm's base damage is actually much, much higher than a Murano's during the first few waves anyway, so he probably doesn't need that much of an advantage, but it's going to be a bit of a delay before he has that bonus DPS.
I mean, obviously with the way that the lanes have ended up, the fact that Ice Shards at the moment on his own, down here on the bottom on the Juggernaut, against the Keeper of the Light Bristleback combination lane, it's going to be hard for him to find the farm, isn't it? How are eHome going to cope with the fact that their Jug might have this harder time in lane?
I think they're banking more on Old 11 making something happen with the, you know, the supposed farm that he's going to be getting, but truthfully, against this Frost Arrow spam, he's not really able to do a lot.
It looks like they're actually going to switch it up.
Yeah.
They're taking Ice up to the top lane, so in turn we're going to see Old 11 head straight down bottom. And as you said, as you expected, this was required from eHome, really, if they do want to find the farm for the Juggernaut.
Well, it's musical lanes. I mean, both teams just rotating heroes everywhere to try to get the advantage here.
I mean, when does it stop? It's, yeah.
One thing about Sand King is that a lot of people are skilling, you know, Caustic nowadays over Sandstorm, so you actually see a lot less, you know, jungle stacking and stuff like that for, you know, Old 11 to be able to get something done. I'm kind of worried for eHome right now because they are making a lot of movement, and I feel like they wanted to be doing better in the lanes than they are, whereas realistically the Bristleback's farming very well, the Storm versus the Murana is kind of tied up at the moment, but I would expect, you know, S4 to start pulling ahead unless he's got three range creeps in his lane, so for now, you know, Alliance, this isn't the start they're looking for.
Absolutely. So the Alliance reacting each and every time to movements from eHome, absolutely worth it, you'd say, with their heroes.
Oh yeah. You just want to make sure that even if you're spending a little bit of money TPing around, you're not giving away a free laning phase to eHome. Because again, with Undying, you want the pressure. You don't want to just walk around the map, teleport around the map, and get nothing done.
See, on the bottom lane, EGM, just come across towards Old 11, just drops down an Ignite, just a bit of harassment, forcing them back, 11 and Old Phantom. him to be careful. And as we can see, CS, the moment, Loader, 4-4, and certainly a lot better than Ice has managed to kick off at the moment. He's, of course, on the safe lane now, as we've seen, but still having to deal with the presence of the Bristleback. And now also Ake coming up as well, so the Colts are back up Bulldogs. So this lane isn't going to get any easier for Ice on the Juggernaut. Now, Alliance, as we can see, CS-wise, top three on the board, all on the side of Alliance. They're certainly playing this early stage a lot better, and they're reading lanes and reacting in a way that's paying off at the moment.
It is a little bit worrisome, but again, Blink Dagger's timing is going to be really key for old 11. That's one thing that Yihong can look to, and they are. We got some pretty decent mid-game. But as far as old Lanham having impact in lanes, he's pretty much doing the only thing he can, is try to contest runes at the moment and just go for trades. But trading against an Ogre is not easy. The hero has very good base regen and 8 armor, so unless you're going to be spamming spells on him, the Ogre is going to be winning most of those trades. He still has a lot of regen, so it's not like the Undying can just sit there and stop even Loda from getting farm at this point. This is probably the most under pressure I've actually seen Ehome in the laning phase the entire stage in TI. I mean, of course, they did split a couple of series, but when the way they draft leads you to believe that they would want to do well in the lanes, and it's just not happening right now.
And as you said, in terms of recovery, it is really just the big item timings, looking for the Blink Dagger on the Sand King and waiting for Evo to start to make the plays to recover from the start.
We'll have to see. They have very good heroes at getting kills. Like, you have the Disruption into Arrow, obviously. You have Epicenter with a Burrow Strike, which is a very good stun against heroes like Storm. And some of the heroes on Alliance are a bit squishy to magical damage. They have ways of making a comeback as long as they're getting their rotations down.
And one thing to note as well, I definitely recall seeing a lot of games through the groups where Bulldog was on the Bristleback, and I mean, he's got to be one of the fastest farmers on the Bristle I've seen. You know, obviously not a lot of heroes, a lot of teams playing it, but if you let him get the space, he is going to get to that point where he's just going to become this unkillable force that can frontline the pushes for Alliance. See what he can do to tackle Bulldog's progression, and of course at the moment with the way that the lanes are going on, he is having absolutely free reign up top, especially with the presence of Ake. Ping him up with the mana. Bulldog, DCS at the moment, and either Fenrir or Ice able to do anything in terms of slowing down the Bristle. Mid lane, Chicken and S4s, the matchup continues, 31 for 7. They're going to try and make a throw on Tasker, looking for the backliner of Alliance. The Blazer, they may just get it, poison down, Eho. Start to break the lane of Alliance up here at top. And we'll go side for Fenrir, can't quite get him. He TP's out in time, but a nice move from Eon to crush the top. And well, hang on. Oh, that. Chung it into S4 behind a tier 2. Little TP himself away, but Eon starting to find the Kraken Alliance's lineup and abuse it there, taking down Ake.
Yeah, they were trying to find something with the Undying during that time, but unfortunately, you're not really going to kill a Storm, especially once he's level 6 and has a little bit of mana to zip away. You need to either land an arrow, get a Burrow Strike into a secondary stun. Those are the setups that you actually have that are going to be able to pressure him. But otherwise, I mean, getting the kill on Makoto is nice. You're going to see a leap away here from this old chicken. But look at the Jug's farm, comparative to Bulldog. Bulldog is the highest farm in the game, and Ice is struggling in this safe lane.
Selfish.
One lane, Eon with the smoke, ready to put some pressure on Ikimatsu. He's going to dispel it. He walks into the two of them. Of course, incredibly beefy on the Ogre. We'll see if he's beefy enough. Old Manon taking away some of the strength. BGM trying to get out. Old Manon body blocking him a little bit. He looks like he's going to be fine. Unless Old 11 can hit the Barrage Strike off. Now, the poison's too much. Unable to deny himself. Eon with the movements now, starting to come on top of Alliance. Loader heading back. Marley so far. Heroes did head down here, already seeing Manon return towards mid, try and get some levels on Undying, but another kill for Eon. Alliance taking a respond by sending three up top by the looks of it. He realizing that Ice actually be on his own, and he is indeed. Ice already backing away from the lane, so not to be caught out by Alliance's movement.
I really like the way that Eon played this. Every single time Alliance picked Bristleback and they put Bulldog in the offlane like this, they do ancient stacks, and they're just warding to protect that. So instead of protecting like your safe lane and mid, they're protecting mid and the offlane. So Eholm probably just making that read and understanding how they like to play the hero and just recognizing that there's not going to be much vision on Alliance's side of the map in regards to the jungle. So whenever they make the rotation, it's much harder to anticipate and it's much harder to dodge. That looks like they're also going to be able to secure the safe lane tier 1. So Eholm, making really big strides here in the early game to recover from the CS and the laning phase.
That's for at the moment. A man to watch has got a haste rune portal. If anything goes down, it's all on the mid lane. Two of them at the moment coming towards. Hard, of course, to make a jump on S4. As looking at EO's draft, obviously, in terms of lockdown, it's pretty much the Burrow Strike, the Arrow, obviously, they've got the setup with the disruption.
Denied!
It could potentially be a hard game to control and contain a Storm Spirit.
Oh, absolutely. Like, it's as well as the panel. There will come a point where if S4 has enough time, he will be pretty much unkillable, barring a perfect combination from the side of EHOME.
See, mid lane, there's a bit of a wraparound from the Sand King. Not quite find an opening. Old Levin, he's got his eyes on S4 from the side. He may try for something. The ping's coming out, but S4 playing it safe. Lane Alliance putting some pressure on, but there'll be a TP in from Vanham as he comes to back up Ice on the defensive. As we said earlier, obviously Ice just struggling to find that farm. He's slowly catching up. A couple of points in the healing ward, keeping him able to stay in lane against Alliance's pressure. Of course, he's playing carefully in Alliance, still yet to be able to find a kill. EHOME, not to throw anything away under the pressure that Alliance were putting on them in the same stage.
It's not as if Alliance need to rush it or anything. Like, normally Drow strategies have some incentive to push towers early, that's always going to be true. But, oh, looks like we're going to see a kill here.
Nice, indeed, comes out immediately, Tombstone drops, and Jug jumps in, and it's a big kill as well. The Bulldog pretty much was right up there, top of the network, stunned a little bit. It's a big kill for EHOME, and the third one so far is four, playing around with a haste rune. Well, just the initial Star Storm with Zap. Can fight through this, but with old Lanham turning up, he's got to be careful. Grabs himself an Indus rune as well in a line. Moving in, zipping forth, he finish up on chicken one more time.
Take me.
And into the Indus straight away. S4's going to be fine. He's very low on the mana, so unable to do anything about old Lanham. But S4, the master of the runes, playing around with a haste and the invis. And he'll take that as well as a bit of a bonus. S4, a kill and a few creeps to boot.
It's such a good start for a Storm to get that kill, get those runes, steal a stack away as well. There's even another large stack on their side of the woods. I think they're going to get that one to Bulldog, but... either way, yeah, Storm getting a really good start in this game is amazing. Get that early bloodstone when you start getting a few charges during fights, just make sure you don't die. You can get out of control real fast. And if you look at the way the EHOME rewarded, they're trying to prevent this from just all these aggressive wards all over the map looking to try to find openings. And they have gotten a little bit of a kill lead so far. But in regards to overall net worth, Alliance are still doing very well.
Absolutely. Let's look on the Sand King. Seeing on our left, we've got 1300 towards the blink. So that's certainly going to be a very, very key item if the one who does get it. At the same time, we're seeing now over on Bulldog, he's just finished off the Vanguard. So next time, and only might not be enough to bring down this Bristle, and especially with the farm he's going to get from this Ancient Staff. EHOME, not in the neighborhood to do anything about this one. So Bulldog, he should be able to claim this. Not any issues at all. I can't make sure he has the mana to do so. At the same time, EHOME, all members up top, ready to push in. See what Lance want to do in reaction. But they may just have to let this one go. They've got the fortification. Loader getting a face down bottom on the Drought. His lane still being farmed up by S4. But Lyra, he's trying to make the most of the other lanes across the map while EHOME put their full efforts towards taking this through.
At least it was alright, like this tower for Alliance doesn't really mean too much. I mean, sure, it means they can drop their aggressive ward and the large camp in the ancient spot, but realistically, they already killed the stack. So the goal that they had for the early game was accomplished before that tower drops. That means that now EHOME probably looking to rotate to get that last tier 1 down. Their team is alright at killing Roshan, it's just extremely slow. Like, they have use of the healing ward, but I think that's kind of a benefit of Alliance's draft, is they do so much more physical damage because of the Drow and having the three ranged heroes plus the Bristleback, who can obviously take away armor from Roshan once he starts getting points into the goop. I think the EHOME are actually going to struggle for a little bit. They are smoked up in mass here.
I'm trying to do something to break this struggle. Be well ahead for the moment, down on the bottom. S4 in the jungle on the Storm Drow. Earlier is in the lane. They don't have the vision of Eve with them though. EHOME going in blind. So if they're able to get a whiff of Eva Hero already. Storm's backing up. Lotus got to be careful. He's on the secret shot. And use the scan, and it's a good scan from Alliance. Realizing that EHOME are moving in, and Alliance is straight out. perfect scout for the team, and Iho won't find anything because of it.
There is a 13-minute Crimson Guard on this Bristleback, by the way. That is completely insane.
Bulldogs farm on the Bristleback. Pretty much every game has been immaculate in these group stages. And now, as we're seeing on the main stage as well, he's able to keep it at that level.
I think that's a little bit... See, I like the Crimson because during the early game, they have a lot of magic damage. It's obviously very good against Tombstone. But once the Sand King gets Blink Dagger, you're also going to want stuff like a mech. Mech you're going to want to fight for sure. Rana will eventually get that Aghanim Scepter going as well. This could be the right item timing for this stage of the game when you know that Alliance can start grouping up and looking to push towers, because it is still like slightly before the Sand King has Blink. Ehome, obviously looking for those openings once Old 11 does acquire that Blink Dagger. For now, Alliance are playing very well.
You can see all the levels. Very close to that Blink Dagger that you talk about. He's 200 gold away. I want to make sure that he gets that safely. But also worth noting as well, as you said, because of Alliance's tools coming together, the Crimson Guard, they have got this pushing power. Good news for them is the fact that, as we can see net worth-wise, they're already very much individually at the top. And there's still 3 tier 1s to the top. Bottom lane, S4, and moving on to Ice for the players. Good start from EGM. Ice gets the shot, but it doesn't matter. Alliance will finish him off. S4 and EGM playing nice. Oh, Levis, all he did is to buy the blink. He needs to spend his gold. I know, he's chill. He knew he was fine. Moonlight Shadow's there. In fact, they may just turn this old chicken coming in. The one players want to add, they'll find one. He had to jump in for another. But some nice level of chill from Sand King, who doesn't panic buy. He's got 2.4k gold. He wanted to buy from the side shop. He'll back up and pick up that Blink Dagger now. Old Levis has that ready for the next engagement. And a big kill for Lions on the bottom lane, nonetheless, getting that ice skill.
S4 needs to be careful. Old 11 wants this Effie Burrow so badly. S4 not going to be greedy, making the right decision to just back off. He knows that Old 11 is missing Blink Dagger timing. 15 minutes in is a relatively standard timing for a Sand King who had as much relating phase as he did. First showcase of the Blink Dagger is going to be really big for Ehome. I mean, obviously the Alliance knows that he has it, but if they start grouping up and trying to push, a well-placed Burrow Epi can kind of bring Ehome back into it really quick.
And they certainly need it as well. I mean, especially considering their teams in this matchup, Alliance and Ehome, and the way that we've seen them perform before. For Alliance to be doing this well off the back of the laning stage against Ehome, I mean, as a team, there's got to be a huge amount of momentum and drive that they're going to be feeling right now. So it's got to feel great to come out of the first 15 minutes like this if you're Alliance.
Yeah, and the other thing too, as we mentioned, a Storm doesn't really have a whole lot of natural counters in this game. The scariest part is the Blink Zanking and then getting arrowed after a Burrow Strike. But other than that, he's pretty much free to do whatever.
That's cool. Picking in Iho. Immediately backing off. But as you said, Iho, they don't want to be the ones to get caught out. They need to find the kicker to start a fight themselves at this stage. Can't let Alliance or S4 dip in onto them. And we're going to see now Old Chicken, Old 11 smoking up. Glides towards the mid lane. Bulldogs on the front. I mean, is he really the hero that you want to be making the jump on? Question. Indeed, holding away from him. I head over towards the top. Loader at the moment was out there. We can see a lot of warding from Ehome out here. They've got good vision at this area. They know the Loader's arriving. This should be a good kill. Old 11 jumps in. We'll see if there's any backup. Arrow to follow for as well. Loader rather tanky, but Old Chicken jumping in with a burst. Can they save this man? They can't. He's going to go down, but Alliance, we're going to look to try and punish Ehome this turn. Old 11. Arrow man. It looks to be out of the people. Moonlight stay. Burrow strikes across. Ghost is still on him, but Alliance will chase him down. They'll punish the Sand King play. Indeed, it is a 1-for-1. Ehome able to get the kill onto Loader.
It's a pretty big kill. Killing him before the Shadowblade comes out. Obviously, already has to recognize the story. Alliance not really feeling too pressured to go for any towers, and after, like, knowing for sure now that the Sand King has Blink, I think it's going to be a little bit before we really see them group up. Wait, at the very least, for S4 to get the Bloodstone. That's going to be one of the bigger things.
Here I am!
And during that time as well, of course, down bottom, it looks like Ice did make a go on S4 with the Omni Slash. He's unsuccessful. Score, he'll keep himself alive. Now Old Lanham, Femre, putting some pressure on the Tier 1. Already TP's coming through from Alliance. They have 4, looking for a push of deny. He's gonna get it. Managed to take a bit of gold away from him. Looking for the Tombstone, and in fact, Bulldog was gonna try and chase, but Femre holds about with the Disruption. Into the arrow, but Bulldog, he already got the Crimson off. So no way that he had him jump in to try and do anything about that. Find the space for them to back up.
Eholm, again, their lineup is going to really struggle to kill Roshan, and that's normally one of the bigger objectives that you have once you've taken all the outer two runs. I mean, they can continually try to push in, but eventually, S4 is going to decide to start coming to team fights. You might get your supports picked off. You know, you think about how MVP played Phantom Assassin yesterday against teams with Shadow Demon. You just go straight to the back line, and you get that quick pick on the hero, and then you just get out. It's pretty much the same thing for a Storm.
I mean, talking about the Storm and the Bristleback, you know, I mean, we keep going back to the Bulldog and S4, but just look at their net worth at this stage of the game to be where they are on these heroes.
They're three powers down, and they still have more net worth, so they're just effectively farming the map a lot better right now than Eholm. But you could also say that Eholm's farm spread is different. Yeah, like Lanham and Fenrir have a lot more farm respectively than Ake and EGMB on the side of the line.
Yeah, but Lanham, of course, as we've just seen, he's picked up a full bail ready for the next farm.
He really wants to help out Old 11. He realizes how critical it's going to be for Epicenter to land and make sure that they get kills, especially when he's tanking. Even his 4 has 1600 health right now.
So then you're going to be able to burst him down immediately, and this will have a chance to escape. They do make a jump on him. Ice, he's getting a little bit more space though. We've seen him sit down here on the bottom lane. Right. Time being, not going to do anything about that. And so Sos, of course, going for the standard Jasher into Battle Fury. Yeah, as you said, in your eyes, Andy, there's not a lot of pressure on Alliance. You don't feel that they need to make a lot happen at this stage, as long as they can keep this farm going at this pace where they consistently are ahead of Eholm on their course.
Yeah, I feel like their late game is going to be slightly better. Obviously, there are things to worry about, like the Tenedaven eventually getting aggro, because the Bristleback, that's really painful, because it gets rid of your path, you can die really quick, but it looks like Eholm.
Alliance, no. Just scanned outside as well, it's been confirmed.
They might be too late though.
Can they get air inside? They may have a chance for some sort of jump.
I mean, they don't even have Bulldog, he's running back to base. So
too late, Eholm able to get themselves the Aegis. Alliance, they want to try and do anything off the back of this. Loda has got the Shadow Blade already, and deep with the Moonlight Shadow, Eholm taking that very, very nicely. Getting the Roshan, taking the Aegis and getting themselves out with no casualties whatsoever. And at the same time, Old Chicken finishes off Aghanim. So Aghanim's an Aegis ready on the Morana for the next fight. Big objective pickup for Eholm. And they're certainly getting to a pass fight. But as we said, you know, with old Lanham's Veil, with the jump in from the Sand King, and the Ice.
Boy.
They're not aware. Ice will be fine. Successful comes over and zips into the tree line, but you see Eholm being very sneaky with his positioning at the moment.
Old 11's also in a very good position as well.
Oh, he's so close. I think they realize. No, they're TPing out. They're TPing out. Ice, he's fine. EGM as well has gone. Ice. They never knew. He's a sneaky one, that down.
I think it's actually a blessing in disguise that Alliance didn't try to go for a fight there. Like, maybe they would have killed Ice before the rest of the team got there. But since they were in such a compact area, there's a good chance that Old 11 gets a really big epicenter and maybe gets a handful of kills. It might have not been a good thing. And not to mention, they did just kill Roshan, so I think it's having the Aegis and the fresh Aghanim. The amount of magic damage that's going to be output with the Veil, Old 11 as well. Or excuse me, Old 9. That is really, really scary for them right now, because they don't have magical damage mitigation. Like, there's no fight, there's no mech on the side of Alliance just yet.
As we can see, the Sith Alliance are going to make a decision to just jump down the top lane mode, trying to pick himself up a double damage rune, and immediately attending to the push up top. Rather, opting to get objectives done rather than fighting to Eholm head on, of course, with this power spike that Eholm have hit with their items, the fact that there's an Aegis as well on the side, but S4! Nice to dodging Old 11's attempt at an initiation. But Eholm will stop Alliance from taking the tier 2 for now. Back up to the top lane. This, of course, giving Ake some space down bottom as he begins this journey towards the Aghanims, and he's already halfway there. Comes up to 1k on top of the point booster. And as we've seen before, if Ake can get that Aghanims in a reasonable amount of time, obviously it's not going to be as quick as some of the games we saw from Alliance in the group stage. It just offers so much to the way that Alliance play as a team.
Yeah, the sustain is ridiculous. Also has the vision, EGM.
Bap clap.
And DP home. Vision for me is going to be the more important thing, actually. Sure, having the sustain is great. Being able to never have to go back to the base is great. But having the ability to see the Sand King is great.
let's see how they play this. Yeah. Is this all?
Not one to mess that one up.
That was a pretty cocky move from S4 to be farming that wave. Like, he knew they were there. There's no way that he just did it.
Been a very tense game. In 23 minutes in, only 3 for 6, but obviously just a little elapsed concentration, little mistakes, and immediately the opponent's will be there to punish. Pulled off. I'm gonna go in on Old Nan. He does have backup Old Nan here. Fenrir and Old Nan come across. Got to set up an S4. Zipping in. Crimson Guard's out. But the Undyne Chieftain has been dropped off. There's a lot onto Bulldog. But still the case out of the chance. If they're gonna get themselves anything else, Old Chieftain being fire blasted by EGM. I don't know. Has turned up for the final shot. After two from Old Nan, but the Blaze here from Undyne. Looking to take EGM. They will find the savior. He kept alive though, S4 stays in the goal! Chicken drive by! Find a third alliance, falling apart here on this top fight. Aki forced back to base, and S4's had to head off to the side. E-Home kind of waiting them in there with the Undying, and Alliance, they're quick to bite, and E-Home are quick to counter react.
Oh, it's really unfortunate for Bulldog. Like, he was trying to get out of the fight, walked right into Ice, who omnates him in the face after he's already at like 30-40% health. Drops really quickly. He wasn't able to really get in as hard as he wanted. I think of all the heroes on E-Home to hit, like hitting the Undying is really kind of a struggle. He actually has a huge amount of armor because he already built a Veil and he has an additional Helm of Iron. Well, he's going to be going for the armor build, which I believe he's done before. This is a very hard Undying to actually get through. So for Bulldog, he wants to go on, like, you know, chase down the Morana, stop it from staying in the fight, perhaps, or maybe even the Sand King, just prevent him from getting really good stuns inside of the fight.
Big 5-3 home, and this is, of course, exactly what we expected to see them looking for. After a laning stage where, you know, Alliance were getting the space, they were getting the farm. When it comes to downright team fights, just seen the E-Home certainly able to outwit the side of Alliance.
I'm over here!
On top, S4. He gets himself out.
That tree saved his life.
Good job as well, because E-Hope, we're coming in hard. As we can see in terms of the build as well, I mean, this Morana, he is, he's getting pretty farmed. As we can see, he's ahead of the Jug at this stage.
It's actually also making a Yule, which I think is really good to stamp. Yeah. There's a couple of uses. Like the first one, knowing that there's going to be an Orchid up and there's going to be Gust on the ground. It's really nice that the spell's sank.
Yeah, he sniffed him out.
It's fine.
Borrow and TP, yep. No way to get the vision. Is that okay? This game at the moment, I feel like. What's the game plan now for Alliance? You just had a bad fight up top. What are you looking to next? Is a certain item? Loader at the moment, he's starting to rack up the gold again on top of the Shadow Blade. Are we going to wait for Alliance to get something else on their hands and then to actively go? Are they going to wait for the next Roshan? What's the plan?
I think getting the Orchid is the first step here for Alliance, or maybe if we can get a quick pick. Saw Ice, but this is not a super easy to kill.
I'm still playing Furiana TP in there immediately. Ice. Straight out. Out of harm's way. Okay, how's the progression looking towards Axe? He's just about got enough money for the third component, so still closing in on that item pickup for Cole.
I'll take that.
The smoke from E-Home. Waltz at the ready. So what kind of a jump in they get? Moonlight to help them close the gap. Already though, Alliance trying to retrieve an old 11. Clipping EGM on the edge. First strike into Arrow. No hope for the Ogre. E-Home. I'm one. They can get themselves anything else. They are looking towards the Coral. And indeed, they've caught him out. Ashe will spend his gold. And E-Home, they're going to look for a second. Ashe on the turn. But no, Ashe's gone. Bonic Purge was dropped from Fenrir. Big chance for them. For the Keeper of the Light. Same time though, S4 looks to fight back. Immediately just goes for the zip TP. S4, realizing he can't take that fight.
It's such a tanky Undying. He's gonna be even tankier once he finishes up that arm one. And right now, E-Home are doing everything properly. They're pressuring the map.
Frodo reveals himself. Well, then an old chicken could go for a stun play, but now. 11-4-4 though, and E-Home certainly starting to break away, and we can see indeed on the top of the board, and now ahead of a Bulldog's Bristleback, which is in itself being incredibly impressive with the amount of farm that Bulldog's been able to get. Orchid is slowly being closed upon by S4.
problem with his Orcus timing this game is there's already a Yule's out on the Murano, so you have to have him pick and use that in some other way before you want to jump him. You can still potentially go for the Sand King, you can still go for the Shadow Demon, that's very true, especially considering that Fenrir is carrying around the gem, so he's actually a fairly high value target at this point. But in regards to killing Horus, he's gonna kind of struggle for a little while.
You see, 1 minute left till Roshan respawn, so point that Ehoma are looking to get, and then try and go even more aggressive. As we've seen though, without the Aegis, Ehome not phased at all, and they have been consistently moving onto Alliance's half of the map, trying to find the kills. In fact, on bottom, this four was there. Oh, he's still there. They're having trouble here, playing around them. Nietzsche is getting close to the TP out, same time top lane. Aegis haven't loaded, they found old Levin on his own. On any kind of detection.
No detection.
Oh, they do have Gust. He doesn't have the mana for Gust either. So old Levin looks like he's gonna get himself away with a freebie hit. But any way to deal with his sanking, it doesn't look like it. Odd Levin's gonna do himself right out of there. Alliance, the tools to take him down.
No, this game's a little bit weird from Alliance for me personally, because like they buy this super early Crimson, they had it at 13 minutes. They didn't really push the powers until quite a bit later. And then Bulldog goes for the SNY before even trying to go for something like that pipe. And the team as a whole feels like it's so scared of the epicenter and team fight, the Murana damage, that they're just avoiding engagement instead of firing.
The setup, the timing is perfect, the arrow as well. Oh my god! Ehome's execution with this combo. Immaculate. Catching the storm every time.
When you can commit those three heroes to guarantee getting a kill on the storm, you're going to all the time. Roshan respawned as well. Ehome still continually maintaining that map control.
And the Ehome into Roshan. Silver lining for Escort, of course, because he did manage to finish off the ult before they took him down there.
He's only got 3 ultimate charges though, that's really the thing that hurts the most. You want a lot of charges to make sure, like during the later stages of the game, if you do end up dying, then you respawn really fast and don't have to expend money on the buyback. It's a big difference, not to mention a part of it.
And the main world is facing the world to take the rush. And Lions, realizing that they couldn't contest that with S4 on the sidelines. I mean, at this point, our Alliance waiting for Ehome to come to them. We can see the Alliance still confident enough to come out onto Ehome's half of the map. Three of them coming into the push up top. We may very well see Ehome just put the pressure on mid and force Alliance to create some sort of a defense and reaction. Looks like Loda going to stick around top for the time being with EGM. Tier 2 is looking very appealing. It's sitting rather low at the moment on the top lane. But indeed, the pressure is being put on by Ehome on this mid lane. And backup may be required for Alliance if Ehome decides to push up to the high ground with the Aegis.
They do have the Keeper Aegis now, at least, so that's going to help a lot. Pushing into this is now extremely difficult to get Ehome. They really only have one hero who's good at hitting towers, and that's Isaias. We've seen a lot of struggles so far here at the TI6, not even group stages, but main stage as well. Teams struggling to break high ground because they pick a lot of melee cores. Ehome backs up from that.
We have the accumulating their push up to the high ground. Running low from Aki, trying to slow down the advance, but Ehome, more down. Very good, the stun. So much damage coming out from this combo from Ehome.
There's no buyback, that's a full minute.
That's a bristleback with 15k net worth on it. It disappears just like that. That's gotta be terrifying.
That is their only frontline hero as well. EGM can do what he wants.
Oh, Ehome! Just jump in, take whatever they want, get straight back out. Just toying with Alliance at the moment on these high ground pushes.
Like, no one was able to help the Bristleback when he was frontlining. That's the biggest issue. You need to try to have somebody up there, like, either have a Cobble Blast. I'm not sure if they just mistimed it, but we're gonna get a chance to see it again. He throws in the Blinding Light, and then we see a double burrow coming in here from Old Eleven, and they just jump straight away. Loda gets glimmered by EGM, but unfortunately at that point, it's kind of already too late. The Homer just gonna eventually be kind of forced back, but can't really afford for your only frontline hero to die that quickly and hope to defend. It's actually kind of a good thing for them that they managed to maintain their racks and only lost the tier 3.
Old Levin coming in, he's just picked up a newfound Agnum Septy. do something with it. EGM at the moment, hiding in the tree behind that. So you can see this vision that old Levy's getting. Simba's rune. I think people at Intel pretty nice. Yeah, and that's what we saw as well after the last fight. You know, old chicken with a knee blade. And old chicken's play has been absolutely perfect. Every time, even in the chaos of these fights, he's always hitting the arrow targets again. Bulldog, there weren't any follow this time from Eho. A little bit of grief as well, so more punch to his defensive capabilities when Eho jump on him. Eho at this stage as well. Do they just group up and go down the mid again? Are they waiting for lines to come out? I mean, if you're Eho, surely you're not that scared at this point.
They can illusion Steve, if anything, right? They just keep disrupting ISIS, they send his illusions on the rain tracks, they kill that, and then if Alliance ever get out of position, all 11 gets a burrow, and potentially they can just take the fight from there.
I'm looking for some kind of wraparound. They will find Fenrir on the back line. This time they're trying to take down the SD. They'll find one. Now, I'm going to keep them having shot the line. Find by Intuist. They'll take the tombstone down. Ice. Just the front is clear on the side. They'll go in the round. The whole team comes in. This time they'll be back. It's an extra for all the members. Fall on down. An alliance where they may be able to take one, take two kills each and every time. Eho just outplaying them in these team fights.
Old 11 is doing so much work on himself. The guy has serious trouble striking. As soon as he got his slim dagger, he has been delivering this entire time. Eho is going to very easily take down the melee rack. They're going to try to make a break at the bottom and see if they can get that victory as well.
This is starting to look very messy for Alliance in game one. And Levy in a bit of a glimmer of hope in the start off the back of a decent laning stage. But Eho, the better tools, the better performance into the mid game. And now, absolutely miles ahead, 80-6. Already jumping in, jumping out. Edge ball comes in with the face. Edge out, remember Eho, but all the damage towards it off.
Says it all, right? Alliance looked really strong in the laning phase. They had the ground strategy. It looked like it was going pretty well. But I feel like Alliance, maybe they got too complacent around the idea that the storm was going to be able to kind of carry the game for them. And I feel like the itemization overall on the Bristleback, I would have personally liked to see the pipe come out a little bit sooner, because they were respecting Old 11 on the Sand King a lot that game in the epicenter, how much damage it would actually do. I think if he had the items to just team fight a lot earlier and they were grouping up, you know, around the Caudal, having the Chakra, having the mech into the Guardian Greaves and whatnot, it was all really good. I think the timing was just off. I think that's the part that Alliance really struggled with.